Hello, I'm Tommy Spaulding. It's an honor to be part of this amazing summit. And I want to thank Wayne for inviting me from Invisible Disabilities. I said yes to Wayne for two reasons. One is because I believe in him and his mission. But two is I have an invisible disability, which we'll get into that in a little bit. I've had the honor to write two New York Times bestselling books, one on leadership, servant leadership, and the other one on the power of relationships. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I grew up in upstate New York. My parents were school teachers. I grew up as a good kid, as an altar boy, grew up Catholic. I was an Eagle Scout. I was class president. I was very involved in high school. But I graduated towards the bottom of my class because of my my invisible disability. I'm severely dyslexic and really struggled academically in high school. And literally graduated high school with a 2.0 GPA, barely even got through school. And I watched my friends graduate high school back in 1987, magna cum laude and summa cum laude. And I graduated high school, thank God almighty, cum laude. I just barely graduated school. And it was a really tough time of my life because I was watching my friends go to Harvard and Brown and Michigan and all these great schools. And there wasn't a school that actually wanted to accept me because of my severe disabilities and my low GPA and low SAT score and so forth. And I remember going to my guidance counselor my senior year in high school, Mr. Tilton, and he wasn't mean. I told Mr. Tilton I want to go to college, I want to go to law school, I want to change the world and make a difference. And he just looks at my grades, he looks at my GPA, he looks at my SAT, he looks at my class rank, and basically hands me a brochure. And if anyone from upstate New York knows, it was from BOCES. And BOCES is a trade school in upstate New York. And he said, Tommy, you know, you have such a severe learning disabilities, I don't think college is really for you. You should go to a technical school, electrician, carpentry, plumbing. And there's nothing wrong with being an electrician or a carpenter or a plumber. They're noble professions. It just wasn't my passion. But I listened to Mr. Tilton, and that's where I was probably headed if I graduated high school in 1987 in God's plan. But God always has an amazing plan. And a month before I graduated high school, this international leadership organization called Up With People came to my high school. And if those don't know about Up With People is this international global leadership musical organization. They did four halftime shows in the Super Bowl. It's an incredible worldwide leadership organization. And they take young people from all over the world, 18 to 25 years old, and they're Christian, they're Jewish, they're Muslim, they're black, they're white, they're rich, they're poor, they're communist, they're capitalist, they're socialist, they're every walk of life, young people. And they do this two-hour musical show. And they came to my high school, and I went to see the Up With People show. I was 17 years old. I'd never been on an airplane before. I had great parents, but they were school teachers. We didn't have a lot of money. We never really traveled. And so I never really been on an airplane and traveled. I thought you need a passport to go to New Jersey. I mean, I'm from New York, and we never really traveled. And so to see this Up With People musical in my high school auditorium changed my life. Because it was all these young people from all over the world, and they had this message about building relationships with people that look and believe and pray different than you. And I was so moved and touched. After the show, I went backstage and I interviewed for Up With People, and it was an honor to be accepted. And so instead of going to BOCES or, you know, community college or so forth, I joined Up With People at 17 years old. And that 1 year turned into 9 years throughout my, you know, 20s and 30s, traveling all over the world with Up With People. And I went to 84 countries, and I lived in over 1,000 host families. And it just really changed my heart, and it really taught me about love. And it taught me about, you know, the power of relationships. And it doesn't really matter about your grades or your GPA. It matters about how you love and serve people. And eventually, the story goes, I spent 25 years on and off with Up With People. And at the age of 35 years old, I replaced the founder of Up With People and became the CEO and president and ran that worldwide organization. And so much of my message to you today about the heart of relationships and how do we build authentic, genuine relationships personally, professionally. Don't come from fancy degrees. I eventually got the fancy degrees, but they don't really matter. What I really learned in life is traveling all over the world Up With People really taught me how to love and serve people well. But I had this dream that I wanted to go to law school. That was my one goal as a kid. When I was 17, 18, 19, 20, 25 years old, I wanted to go to law school. At the time, I wanted to get into public service. I thought I wanted to be governor of New York and become a U.S. senator. I want nothing to do with politics today, but unfortunately. But when I was a kid, I used to love politics. I majored in college and so forth. And I wanted to go to law school. And so when I finally graduated college, I went to a school called East Carolina University. It took me 5 years to graduate with a 2.0 GPA. Again, my invisible disabilities, my dyslexia struggled all the way through, finally got a degree, barely graduated college, and now it's time to apply to law school. And I knew I wasn't gonna go to some prestigious law school like Harvard or Yale or Princeton or MIT, you know, these great law schools. And so I researched. There's actually 435 approximately accredited law schools throughout North America. That's a lot of law schools. I just had to find one that would accept me. And so I researched, what are the bottom 37 law schools in the country? Like, what are the easiest 37 schools? And I applied to those 37 schools. And you know, it's interesting, I never shared this story with anybody. I always was ashamed of my invisible disabilities. I was always ashamed of my dyslexia and my learning disability, and my ADHD and my OCD, and I had all kinds of stuff. I was always ashamed of it because I don't want people to think I wasn't smart. So I never shared this story with anybody. When I wrote my first book, It's Not Just So You Know, I wrote the story, and I'm going to tell you the story. This is the original file that I've had in my desk since 1995. And these are actually the original 37 rejection letters of the worst law schools in North America. Like, every one of them rejected me. Like, how do you know there's 37 ways to politely tell someone to go take a hike? Like, I regret to inform you. I regret to inform you. I regret to inform you. I cannot offer you a position. Unfortunate limited size. I'm genuinely sorry. This is my favorite one from Mercer University. This was a difficult decision. Yeah, bullshit. Difficult decision. Not a difficult decision. I graduated college with a 2.0 GPA. 37 of the easiest law schools rejected me. And it was a really tough time in my life because I didn't have a plan B. All those years traveling the world with other people, I always thought I'd go to college, go to law school, and get into public service. And then now every law school rejected me. And it's incredible how God just put me on this path, because I was actually living and working in Japan at the time. And I got all these rejection letters from law schools. And I went through depression. I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. I was fearful. So I decided to go to Bali, Indonesia to do some scuba diving. I was single. I wasn't married at the time. And I used to love scuba diving. And I was on this dive boat with a bunch of strangers. I'm sitting next to this woman from Atlanta, Georgia, of all places. And we started talking, and I was telling about Up With People and all my years traveling all over the world with Up With People. And now I'm working for the Olympics in Japan, and just kind of tell her about myself. And she said, have you ever heard of Rotary International? I said, of course. Rotary is like this global service organization. I think their mission statement is service above self, servant leadership. And she's very involved with Rotary. She said, Tommy, with your experience traveling the world with Up With People and all these incredible experiences you had serving other people and Eagle Scout and president of your class in college and high school and all these things, you should apply for the Rotary International Ambassadorial Scholarship. And I've never heard of the Rotary International Ambassadorial Scholarship. And she said, Tommy, it's like one of the most prestigious scholarships in the world. Rotary gives $50,000 to one American that goes abroad, that gets their master's in business or whatever. And in Rotary, in turn, you're an ambassador, and you go around that country that you live in and speak about servant leadership, and you'd be a shoo-in. And if you're accepted as a Rotary Ambassadorial Scholar, you get pretty much an automatic acceptance to any business school you want to go to. Well, I'm on this dive boat about to jump off and do some scuba diving, and I didn't hear a word this lady was saying except automatic acceptance. This is how I get into the business school. They don't have to see my transcript. If I become a Rotary Scholar, then I can... you know, circumvent this process and get into law school. They don't have to see my transcript. So I went back to Japan. I wrote away for the application. I spent 7 days, the whole week, filling out this application. And I talked about my experience with Up With People. I talked about growing up in upstate New York. My parents, a big, you know, Catholic family, wanted to have a big family, and they had two miscarriages after me. So they decided to adopt a little girl from Korea. So I have a Korean sister in hell. That was amazing. Growing up with someone different than me. And I talked about my roommate in college was Chad Harris, and we were fraternity brothers, and one day he decided to drink too much and dove off a dock head first, and he didn't get an invisible disability. He got a visible disability. He became a quadriplegic. And I lived with him for 2.5 years. And to live with a quadriplegic during my college years really formed my heart about, you know, the guy can't move, yet he had an incredible attitude. He was paralyzed from the neck down. He had this will for life. And sometimes I got a little depressed about my learning disabilities and my challenges and so forth. And so he humbled me and set me on this, you know, the right path. And I spent the whole weekend filling out this application. Why I should be chosen for this $50,000 Rotary Ambassadorial Scholarship. And the last question on the 7-page application was, what's your GPA? And it said 4.0 is required to apply for this scholarship. Well, I didn't have a 4.0. And I spent the whole weekend filling out this application. But I didn't want to lie, so I had to write the truth. So I wrote what was required. I wrote 4.0 because it was required. So I put a little asterisk next to the 4.0 and I flipped over the application and I wrote in very small handwriting, "Dear sir or ma'am of the Rotary Ambassadorial Scholarship Committee, if you took my high school GPA and you added it to my college GPA, I had a 4.0 and I submitted the application. I didn't think I would ever hear from this Rotary Ambassadorial Scholarship Committee ever again. And a few weeks later, I get a letter in the mail. And it wasn't one of these 37 rejection letters. It was a letter from Rotary International from Evanston, Illinois, the world headquarters, from the president saying out of 800 of the top college graduates in North America, they chose 10 final candidates to interview for this $50,000 Rotary Ambassadorial Scholarship. And I was honored to be one of those 10 final candidates. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that I was one of the 10 final candidates. And I called my dad. I had to borrow $1,000 from him because I didn't have any money because I was broke because I spent them all on these damn law school applications. I had no money. And I borrowed $1,000 from my dad. I flew back from Japan to New York and I drove upstate New York, a little town called Peekskill where all the interviews are being held for this Rotary Ambassadorial Scholarship. And I'm jet lagged. I had a 16-hour flight. I'm exhausted. I'm nervous. I get out of my suit. I walk to a little Italian restaurant, and these 10 very distinguished Rotarians were there greeting the 10 final candidates, the college graduates that were interviewing for this Rotary scholarship. And the Rotary chairman asked all the 10 candidates to wait in the bar area, lounge area of this Italian restaurant. And they're going to call each one of us one by one, alphabetical order, into a banquet room to have a private interview for about 30 minutes. And I did the math. My last name is Spaulding. And so I had about a 3.5-hour wait alphabetically before my name got called. So I was a little nervous, so I started talking to the other 9 candidates, introducing myself. They were from Harvard, Yale, Princeton, some of the best schools in the country. And I went to East Carolina University. No one even heard of that school. This was the most stuck-up group of people I've ever met. No one was talking to each other. Everyone was kind of spread around the lounge area, kind of getting ready for their interview and, you know, studying their notes. And this was war. And this was a $50,000 scholarship, only one person's winning, and no one was talking to each other. And I had a 3.5-hour wait. So I went up to the bar in the lounge area, and I sat at the bar, and I ordered a Diet Pepsi. And I started talking to the only person at the bar, which was the bartender. Turns out that it wasn't just the bartender, but he was the owner of this fourth-generation Italian restaurant. And my mom is 100% Italian, I'm half Italian, and my grandparents had a huge influence in my life, who were Italian. And so I started talking about Italy. And before you know it, this guy takes out his menu and goes over his grandpa's meatballs and auntie's pasta and he brings out his yearbooks and photo albums. And I learned a whole life story about this guy. And I met his wife and his kid, the fifth generation owner of this restaurant. And we had this incredible conversation. I got to really know his story. Anyway, my name got called. I went into this room, 10 Rotarians in a long table, all looking at me. And I can tell right away there was a woman holding my transcript from East Carolina University, and she wasn't too happy with me. And she said to me, I don't really appreciate your 2 + 2 = 4 humor. I don't know how you got it into the final 10 because you need a 4.0 to apply. And they didn't really appreciate my humor on that. And she said, but you flew over from Japan. You might as well tell us why you should win this $50,000 scholarship. And I looked at the committee and I said, my whole life, I've been measured by a GPA, by an SAT, by my class rank, by law school applications. The way the world works when you're young is how smart you are and how successful you're gonna be. And your purpose on this planet is all by academia and grades and GPAs and so forth. And I grew up in the resource room. And they called that the retard room when I was a kid. You know, with kids with Down syndrome and autism and dyslexia, they didn't know what to do with kids in public school. They put them all in the same room, the resource room. And I think there's beautiful people that come from the resource room because I'm not going to be judged by my GPA or my SAT score, my law school applications. I'm going to be judged by how I love and serve people, and I'm going to change the world. And I must have done a pretty good job, because here's how this amazing story ends. They voted. These 10 Rotarians voted. Oh, they can only give one $50,000 scholarship. And it was a dead tie. One person that they voted for graduated magna cum laude from Harvard University. She got 5 votes. And the other person they voted for was me, Tommy Spaulding, with a 2.0. So 5 people on this committee voted for the Harvard girl, and 5 people on the committee voted for Tommy. So 5 and 5, there's a tie. So they voted 3 different times. I wrote this story, my first book, It's Not Just Who You Know. And it was incredible. I heard the story years after it happened. The chairman voted 3 different times, each time they voted, hoping someone would change their vote. It was always 5 for the Harvard girl, 5 for Tommy, 5 for the Harvard girl, 5 for Tommy. So finally, after all day of interviews, the chairman says, I tell you what, we've been in this room all day, we're exhausted, let's go to the bar and get a drink, we'll have a couple cocktails and talk about it. So the committee of 10 people get up, they walk over to the bar, bartender serves them all drinks, they're having a couple cocktails. It's like a Miller Lite commercial, you know, Harvard girl, Spaulding, Miller, you know, the taste great, less filling, taste great, less filling, Spaulding, Harvard. This committee is around the bar debating over who should win the scholarship. And finally, after a couple cocktails, the chairman looks at his watch and says, I'll tell you what, got to go home. It's now 6 o'clock, time to go home. We can only give one scholarship, one $50,000 scholarship. Let's just have one last vote. Someone's got to change your vote. How many for the Harvard girl? 5 people raised their hand. How many for Tommy Spaulding? 5 people raised their hand. The chairman didn't know what to do. And he looks up and he sees the bartender. And he's got this idea. Hey, bartender, come over here. Bartender says, what's up? Chairman says, you were in the room all day, weren't you? Bartender says, well, yeah, this is my place. And so the chairman says, well, you must have met all the 10 candidates. You've been there all day. Who do you think should win the $50,000 Rotary International Ambassadorial Scholarship? And the bartender said, I didn't meet any of the other 9 candidates, but that Tommy Spaulding kid, that kid came up the bar, sat down, and he talked to me for 3.5 hours. What a genuine, nice kid. The bartender was the deciding vote, and I won the $50,000 scholarship. It changed my life. I wrote that in my book, and I actually think that's the reason why the book became a New York Times bestseller, is that people just love that story. And the story is not about, after you've finished this webinar, make sure you get in your car and drive to the local bar in your hometown and get to know your bartender. That's not what the moral of the story is. The moral of the story is relationships matter. And building authentic, genuine relationships matter even more. And what that story really, really taught me was we live in a world, in business, in personal and professional relationships, where we qualify who we want to be nice to and who we don't want to be nice to. Not that we want to be mean to people, but we spend a lot of our exhausted efforts being nice to and building relationships, people that can help us, people that have influence. And maybe we're not as nice to people like the bartender. But what I've learned in Up With People, when you have a love of people, you have a love of all people, you never know who's gonna bless you. And because I had a genuine, genuine interest of learning and meeting that bartender, he was the deciding vote. And I won that $50,000 scholarship. I went to Bond University in Australia, got a master's in business. And after I got out of business, I worked for IBM and I started my career and the blah, blah, blah. And it was this the tipping point of my life. 37 law school rejections. And a bartender changes the course of my life because I had a passion of getting to know his story. And so that's what we're here to talk about, is the power of relationships. And my father, it was an English teacher, started me off when I was a kid. I was in 8th grade and I was laying in bed. And my father was a very shy, humble, quiet, socially awkward, beautiful heart kind of guy. And he comes to my bedside and he says to me, you know, you're not very academically gifted or athletically gifted or artistically gifted. And I looked at him and said, thanks, Dad. He says, but you have a gift of relationships. Ever since you were a little boy, the way you build relationships with people. And he told me these stories about when my older sister was selling, you know, Girl Scout cookies. I would help her sell it, and I'd sell more Girl Scout cookies than all the Girl Scouts. And I'd shovel driveways around the street to make money, and everyone wanted me in the neighborhood wanted me to shovel the driveway because I called them yes sir and yes ma'am, and went inside and got to know their story. And you had all the neighbors that loved you, and even my family reunions, my mom's Italian family reunions, hundreds of cousins would be at these family reunions, and you would set up kissing booths to make money. You were this little entrepreneur, and you want to meet people, and you set up this kissing booth called Kissing Cousin Tommy. And, you know, 5 cents if you kiss me on the cheek and 10 cents if you kiss me on the lips. And I'd raise like 20 or 30 bucks at these reunions. And don't laugh, because it's not fun when your grandmother puts a 20 down and says, pucker up, Tom Tom. I mean, but my grandfather and grandmother were a huge influence in my life, and always went to the kissing booth. And so my father reminded me just of the gifts I have, and that relationships are more important than anything. And my father said, all the people making A's and B's in high school and college and business school are going to work for you one day, even though you got D's and F's, because you're heart of people. And then he gives me this gift. And he gives me this gift that it's actually this. This is the gift. This is the book. It was How to Win Friends and Influence People. He hands me this book on my bedside at eighth grade and says to me, I know you probably can't read this, but we'll read this together. But Dale Carnegie will teach you how to build and influence people, how to build relationships, and how to win friends and influence people. And this book is just falling apart, but it's my cherished book. It's my one gift. My father really gave me that, set me on the path of building relationships. And then we read it together. Over 20 million copies sold, one of the greatest books written of all time. And I think it's still on the New York Times list in many weeks. It's still on the list, which is incredible because it's 70 or 80 years old. And we talked about, you know, in the book, my father and I talked about the book, and Dale Carnegie talks about you have to do these 10 different tactics to really win friends and influence people. And if you read the book and you do these 10 different tactics, that you'll be able to win friends and influence people. And the tactics are, number one, look people in the eye when you talk to them. When you shake people's hands, shake them hard, give them a firm handshake, and draw them in. Whole chapter on handshaking. Don't talk about yourself. Talk about other people. Ask about them. You know, ask about their interests. People don't want to talk about that, you know, listen to people talking about themselves all the time. And then it talked about a chapter, avoid conflict. Don't talk about things that are going to upset people. It had all these different tactics in life. And we read this book, and I became a master at these tactics. Went on the, you know, high school and went to class president, went on to college, became class president, fraternity president. And I learned how to win friends and influence people better than anybody. And it became like my crutch. Because when you have a disability, like dyslexia, you have this handicap, right? You want to overcompensate it. And so I overcompensate it with having this incredible personality of winning friends and influence people. And this book really put me on the path. But as I grew older and got deeper in my Catholic faith and my Christianity and really studying Jesus and the servanthood and the humility he had, and as I got older and more mature and I got married, and when you get married, it's the most humbling thing, because every night you go to bed with this beautiful woman that basically tells you what a jerk you are and all the things you need to work on to improve yourself. And so marriage is absolutely humbling. Being a father is humbling. I'm a stepfather. That's humbling. And so as I grew older, I realized, as much as I love this book, and I think this book set me on the path of building authentic relationships, it actually wasn't enough. That Dale Carnegie's book did not get you to where you really need to get with relationships. You can't use tactics to win friends and influence people. Just because you look people in the eye, shake people's hand, speak about their interests, avoid conflict, doesn't mean you're building authentic relationships. And that's what really inspired me to write my first book, It's Not Just Who You Know. And it really was basically dubbed the 21st century Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People, which is a huge honor. But as much as I respect Dale Carnegie's masterpiece, it's not enough. If you want to build lifelong relationships, if you want to build lifelong customers, lifelong clients, lifelong employees, lifelong marriages, lifelong relationships with your children, lifelong neighbors, if you want to truly build genuine, authentic relationships, you can't be manipulative. You can't use crap stuff like looking people in the eye and shake people's hand and these tactics. It can't be manipulative. It has to come from an authentic, genuine, heartfelt space. And so the book I wrote 10 years ago, our anniversary is this year, is called the five floors of relationships. And every relationship that you have, every relationship, personally and professionally, lives on five floors. Every relationship you have on this planet lives on five floors, whether they're work relationships, professional relationships, or they're personal relationships. And I'm gonna go through them. The first floor relationships are transaction relationships. We have hundreds of them every week. You're walking to Starbucks, how are you? They say, I'm fine. And they say, how are you? And you're fine. And you don't really mean, how are you? You don't really mean, I'm fine. You just say these things, these transaction relationships, the bartender, the barista, the bank teller, the Uber driver, the person at the McDonald's, I mean, the mailman. I mean, transactional, hi, how are you? They're transaction relationships. First floor. Second floor relationships is what I call NSW relationships. NSW, wrote a whole chapter in a book about NSW relationships, and that stands for news, sports, weather. News, sports, weather. Small talk. I live in Denver. How are the Broncos doing? I'm a huge Yankee fan. How are the Yankees doing? The Yankees doing good. What's the weather like? How are things going in Colorado? How's the COVID going? How many cases you got? It's just small talk. It's news, sports, weather. And there's nothing wrong with NSW relationships. When you first meet people, you know, to get to know someone, sometimes you kind of talk about new sports weather. Oh, in New York, I went to a restaurant. You ever been to this restaurant? It's small talk. And small talk is important when you're meeting people for the first time. But now I've been coaching executives and I've been coaching leaders for almost 25 years, teaching them how to build authentic relationships in their culture, their organizations. And there are an incredible amount of leaders, thousands and thousands and thousands of leaders around the world that never move past the second floor, the NSW small talk with their customers, with their clients, with their employees, and even sometimes with their families. It's tragic. You have to at least move to a third floor where you have some sort of vulnerability. We start telling your story and being opening up who you are. And you, when you're vulnerable, it's contagious. Because when you're vulnerable to someone, you talk about your dyslexia or your challenged teenage kid or your marriage that's struggling or your job that's you got fired or your company that's, you know, low in sales. When you start getting vulnerable, it allows other people to feel safe and they get vulnerable. And you move to a fourth floor. And when you have a fourth floor relationship, you're not trying to win their business. You're trying to listen to them and learn about how you can help them. I wrote a whole chapter in my book about networking. You always hear this thing about networking and people read my book and they say, oh, it's the best networking book, and I hate that. I cringe when I hear the word networking because I wrote a chapter in the book and say, networking is the evil empire. It's Darth Vader. It's the worst. It's the most selfish act on earth. If you really dissect the word networking, we go to all these networking events. Networking is about what? Really skin the onion, really peel back the onion. What's networking all about? It is building relationships to help us. It's selfish. And so I wrote a whole chapter about shifting from networking to net giving. You're still meeting a lot of people, but when you net give, when you meet people, instead of saying, how could this person help me? When you meet people and you're moving up the floors of relationships, you're asking yourself, how could I help them? And when you live a life of helping and serving others and building fourth floor relationships, your life becomes incredible. And your business prospers, and your marriage prospers because you're having a servant's heart. And that's when you get to a fifth floor relationship. And that's when you're living the four most important words of leadership, the four most important words of marriage, the four most important words of being a father or wife or mother or husband. The four most important words of life are, it's not about you. It's not about you. And most of us, 99% of us, live a life where it's about us. So I've been in this leadership development space now for almost 25 years, coaching Fortune 500 CEOs, speaking to thousands of organizations all over the world on leadership. And if I had to really summarize 25 years, two best-selling books on the subject of servant leadership and authentic relationships, here's what I've learned. There's two types of leaders in the world. There's two types of husbands, wives, two types of parents, two types of any profession you have. There's two types of human beings on this planet. There's servant leaders, those that serve others before themselves. And then there's self-serving leaders, those that serve themselves first and then others. But it doesn't mean you're a jerk if you're a self-serving leader. It just means you're a self-serving leader. And here's the rub. About 90% of the world are self-serving leaders. To be what I call a heart-led leader, I wrote a whole book on it, to be a servant leader, to live a life like Jesus did when he got on his knees and washed the feet of his disciples, I mean, to truly put others first. About 10% of the world are servant leaders. 10% of the world are what I call heart-led leaders. 10% of the world build genuine, authentic relationships to help and serve other people. And they build what I call these fifth floor, the five floors of relationships, these fifth floor relationships where they totally are servant. You want nothing from them. All you want them is to love and serve them. And when you build fifth floor relationships, you're authentic, you're genuine, you're caring, you're not thinking about what you can get from them, you're not being manipulative, you're just serving them, serving their family, serving their employees, just giving to them, that you'll live a life of what I call penthouse relationships, fifth floor relationships, and you'll have such an incredible life because your business will prosper because your customers will know you're authentic and genuine. And they know, your customers and your clients, they know that you're not trying to win their business. You're actually trying to win their heart. And when you win people's hearts, you get their business for life. And your marriages are different. Your relationship with your children are different. And I've learned in life, there's two types of relationships with your kids. I have young kids. And my wife and I say we want to do one thing right, well, two things right with our kids. We want to teach them to love the Lord. But the second thing we want to do is we want to teach our kids is that when they get older, that they don't have to visit us, what I call the obligatory visit. We all have parents that we have to oblige and visit them at certain holidays to be respectful to our parents. But we would never go on vacation with them or hang out with them or want them to be part of our lives because it's dysfunctional. But I have some friends, very few friends, that have parents that as they got older and they had children of their own, they still want to hang out with their parents. Because they choose to hang out with their parents, because they built an authentic, genuine relationship with them. They built fifth floor relationships, not small talk, not manipulative, but real authentic relationships. So if you want to have lifelong relationship with your kids and their grandkids and so forth, you got to change your heart to serve other people. And so that's really basically the gist of the five floors relationships. It's a choice. And I just want to challenge everyone, you know, on this podcast, in this webinar, in this summit. One exercise you can do after you finish listening to me is go get a piece of paper. Just go get a piece of paper, blank piece of paper, and write down 1 through 10. And think about, okay, professional. If you all work. Write down 10 names of people you work with, 10 of the most important people in your business, 10 of the most important clients, customers, employees, whatever line of work you do. Write down 10 people at work that are most important people in your life. And if you don't work, write down 10 people of your personal life, the most important people in your personal lives. Write down 10 the most important people in your life. And then ask yourself, what level of relationship do you have with each one of those people? Do you have a first floor transaction relationship? Do you have a second floor NSW small talk? Do you have a third floor where you're vulnerable? Do you have a fourth floor where you know their story, that you really listen to who they are and you're trying to help them? Do you have a fifth floor where all you want to do is serve and love them? And, you know, really work on that. You know, people hire me to kind of build cultures of what I call ROR in their organization. Because America has been brainwashed with companies. We've been brainwashed from business school onward that the most important thing in corporate America is what? Every company is valued at what? Return on relationships. Return on investment, ROI. ROI is everything. Return on investment. But if you could change that and say, okay, ROI is important, but the one thing that's even more important than ROI is ROR, which is return on relationships. If you can build a culture and organization where you're building authentic, genuine relationships, that'll increase the ROI. And so this is things that you need to ask yourself is that when you go to work every day, when you walk the neighborhood, when you go to church, when you go to your temple, whenever you're out in the community, you know, do you want to build servant relationships and helping other people, or do you want to build self-serving relationships? And every day when you go to work, and every day when you go downstairs to be with your children, you have to ask yourself, what type of leader am I going to be? Am I going to be a servant leader today and serve others before myself? Or am I going to be a self-serving leader today and serve myself first? And it's a question every day. And when you become a heart-led leader, it's a choice every morning when we live. But how do we want to live our life? And I know the days that I'm happiest, the relationships that are really authentic and genuine, is when it comes from a place of love. And love is really, really everything. And so I hope we're able to take some lessons over the short little summit webinar, that we want to build more authentic, genuine relationships, that relationships do matter. And we want to build more third, fourth, and fifth floor relationships. We take this this relationship audit and look at all the names of the people in our lives that are important, and we spend our days investing in these people. And not asking yourself how these people can help you, but asking yourself how you can help these people. The greatest leadership decision that we'll all make in life is what our leadership philosophy is going to be. I mean, we have a religious philosophy. You know, I'm Christian, I'm a Catholic. You might be Jewish or Muslim or Buddhist. We have a religious philosophy. We have a political philosophy. You might be a Republican or a Democrat or a liberal or a socialist, but you have a religious philosophy. You have a political philosophy. What's your leadership philosophy? What's your leadership philosophy? I guarantee no one's ever asked you that, but you have a religious philosophy. You have a political philosophy, but yet you don't have a leadership philosophy. Yet most of us go to work every day, 9 to 5 or 8 to 6 or 50, 60 hours a week. If you're gonna go work and leading people, you should have a leadership philosophy. And I believe that leadership philosophy is servant leadership. It is heart-led leadership. It is taking those relationships to the third, fourth, and fifth level and living a life of serving other people. And when you do live a life of serving other people, your business will prosper. And more importantly, your life will prosper as well. Thank you so much for having me on your webinar. I enjoyed our talk.